One of the major reasons why farmers are in distress for the past few years is because of excess supply of food grains. So when you have excess supply of agricultural output, then automatically it will lead to reduce the price of most of these agricultural outputs. And reduced price, as Dr. Ram rightly pointed out in the case of red grams, right? So the price goes even below the cost of production, and therefore the farmers will have to be in distress, and sometimes they commit suicide because of various other factors, like over exploitation of groundwater and so on and so forth, which increase the cost of production, right, and affect the profitability. Okay, so if you carefully read the Niti Aayog's document that talks about doubling farm income, okay, for the past few years we are thinking about talking about doubling farm income. This year the government was very firm in terms of doubling farm income, and that is the reason why they have announced MSP, minimum support price, for 14 Kharif crops. The minimum support price is equivalent to 150% of the cost of production. Okay, so by doing that, the government thinks that one can increase the farm income. Of course, we have to appreciate the effort taken by the government in terms of increasing the farmers' income. But when you look at the policy document prepared by Chand in the year 2016, what we find is that it is basically the old wine in the new bottle. Okay, so they list out some of the measures which are already there for decades together. Okay, increasing the productivity, increasing the soil, improving the soil health, so on and so forth. Nothing new. And the MSP, for example, which aims at increasing the productivity, production, all those kinds of things, does many bad things in the economy. Basically, when the MSP increases, it increases the price of the agricultural commodities as well, unnecessarily. So there is an inflation, especially food inflation, which will affect the poorer people of the society. Still, there are 30% of the people in India who are living under poverty line, okay, so they have to buy food. So it is an inflationary kind of strategy which affects the poorer section of the society. When the agricultural outputs are used up as inputs in industry, for example, cotton textile industry utilizes cotton as an, then that will also lead to increased price of industrial output, which affects the poorer section of the society. So in many different ways, the poorer people are getting affected because of increased agricultural, especially the MSP, because it is being artificially kept high. The second problem with the MSP is that MSP does not work properly. Only 16% of the farmers have been benefited out of MSP. And in 2006, this Santa Kumar committee has found that only 7% of the farmers were aware of MSP as such. And even if the farmers are aware, and if they take their producers to the market committee where they can sell the producers at MSP, the procurement is not properly done actually. I have seen in Tanjavur Delta region farmers bringing their paddy and waiting for 7 days, 8 days for selling their produces at the market committee. Okay, so these are some of the problems. Second thing is, if we keep on increasing the MSP, then the government will have to allocate more resources, public resources, taxpayers' money, for procuring this food grains and then selling it at the PDS outlets and things like that, in order to serve the poorer people actually. So it increases the kind of transaction cost of the governments also, in terms of in order to implement this this particular kind of measure. And then you have problems like environmental destruction. MSP for paddy, sugarcane leads to increased use of groundwater, and it leads to over-exploitation of groundwater, and therefore it increases the water footprint, as Dr. Ram rightly pointed out. The water footprint increases because of increased level of MSP. So the point here is that there are a whole lot of problems revolving around MSP. It may not necessarily benefit the farmers, and nor the consumers also. Now consumers will have to pay more because of this policy. Rather, can we look at alternative kind of measures by which both the farmers as well as the consumers can benefit out of these measures? Okay. So nowadays we are talking about demand-based food production. I think that you know what Dr. Ram and CSA are basically doing is to create a demand-based kind of food production. Actually, you know, that's very important. So, at the macro level, one can easily estimate what is the demand for rice, for example, in a given year. It takes into account the domestic demand as well as the demand from the export. Actually, what is the demand for sugar, both domestic as well as the export demand? What is the demand for other various commodities that are being governed by MSP, or major commodities? Okay, so let us estimate the demand for each and every commodity, and then the supply of these commodities will have to be regulated. How do you do that? Exactly what Dr. Ram and CSA are doing. You go to the farmers at village level, you ask the farmers two questions. One is, are you willing to cultivate any crop in the coming season? If so, what crop? And in how much area? Very simple questions. And the village administrative officer or some the producer organization at the village level can elicit information on these three questions. Actually, okay, two questions: what is the crop that you are going to cultivate, and in how much area? This will give us what would be the total supply of each and every crop actually, and the supply will be matched with the demand. In certain cases, the supply will be much higher than the demand, and that tells you whether the price of that particular commodity is going to crash after harvesting. Right now, if you look at the measures taken by the government in order to inform the farmers, it is only the measure that takes place only after post-harvest period actually, you know. Once the farmers have cultivated their crops, and we are now telling them, look, if you take your products to market X, you will get a better price. It does not help the farmers actually. But if you pre-plan everything, estimate the demand for each and every commodity, and then regulate the supply accordingly by providing information to the farmers well in advance, before the crop is being cultivated. So supply and demand will match. There is no problem of price crashing. There is no problem of increased price for some of the commodities, right? So demand based kind of this thing. I think that the entire thing can be, you know, fine tuned towards this, because you are doing the demand based kind of approach for stabilizing the price actually. Okay. So this is one thing. The second thing is, when you ask the farmers, see, basically what is going on here is, once you have estimated the demand, once you have identified that some of the goods are going to be produced, overproduced or underproduced, then you can ask the farmers to change the cropping pattern depending on the agroclimatic conditions, etc. And when you try to influence the farmers to change the cropping pattern, you can also achieve one more thing, namely you can nudge the farmers to change the cropping pattern in an ecologically friendly manner. So how are we going to do that? So that is where the payment for ecosystem services approach comes in. So what is this payment for ecosystem services approach? Of course, Dr. Ram has basically talked about the footprints, ecological footprints and things like that in detail. I am not going to discuss about that. But I am going to talk about the ecosystem services approach. What are these ecosystem services? When we look at the environment, apart from the marketable outputs like food grains, fodder and things like that, the ecological system, environmental system, whether it is agriculture or water ecosystem or forest ecosystem, they all produce, generate lot of ecosystem services that are not at all traded in the market. They are highly valuable to the society. Okay, so they have been classified into four different categories by this kind of program called TEEB, so on and so forth. Okay, so the very first kind of ecosystem services generated by this environmental system is called production or provisioning service, which includes food, water for drinking purpose, fodder, fuel, timber, biochemical materials, genetic resources, ornamental benefits, the whole lot of services that are being used up in consumption and production purposes for improving the welfare of the people actually. And then you have whole lot of regulating services. We don't look at all, at these regulating services coming from these ecosystem services. Regulation services resulting from the capacity of ecosystems to regulate climate, hydrological services, biochemical cycles, earth surface processes and a variety of biological processes, air quality regulation, carbon sequestration. For example, Dr. Ram spoke about carbon neutral villages, okay, carbon sequestration, okay, climate regulation, gas regulation, air quality regulation, filtering services that remove organic materials and chemicals from the water, regulation of the timing and volume of river flow, groundwater flow. Right now in Tamil Nadu, for example, sand mining is going on in a very rampant manner actually. Enormous amount of sand is being removed from the river beds, which does affect the flow of timing and volume of river water. That is why, you have flooding. Very recent flooding in Kerala, for example, has been attributed to this, quarrying in Western Ghats and other issues going on in the Western Ghats, okay? You might have read various interviews given by Professor Madhav Gadgil, okay? So how this destruction has been caused by the human intervention in terms of the natural regulation that is being generated by the natural system actually. Protection against floods, okay? And in Chennai, for example, there is a wetland called Pallikarani wetland, which used to have 5,000 hectares of land area under the water actually. But now it has been restricted to 635 hectares. So we have lost huge amount of regulation, flood regulation service. As a result, even for a small rain, the Pallikarani area, Madavakkam, all these places are getting affected by floods actually. So flood regulation has been completely lost. Okay, and then you have regulation of erosion, sedimentation, species reproduction, breakdown of excess nutrients and pollution, pollination. In agriculture, we have lost enormous amount of pollination service, if at all, exactly. So because of organic cultivation, we are now retaining huge amount of pollination service. And we have not recognized this pollination service, which helped the farmers and other producers. And now, one of the major services that come back because of organic cultivation is this pollination service actually, okay? And regulation of pests and pathogens, protection against storms, protection against noise and dust, biological nitrogen fixation, waste treatment, nutrient regulation, biological control, and so on and so forth. And it's not only enormous amount of regulation service, but also you have cultural services, okay, coming from the natural system. So cultural services relate to the benefits people obtain from ecosystems through recreation, cognitive development, relaxation, spiritual reflection, so on and so forth. Nature and biodiversity services coming from the nature, provision of cultural, historical, and religious heritage, provision of scientific and educational information that comes from the nature, provision of opportunities for recreation and tourism. Indeed, you know, there is enormous potential for developing tourism in the nature sector, which has not yet been recognized. Sometimes the tourism works against the nature also. So what we want is, it's not just tourism as such, but how to promote ecotourism in some of these areas is very important. In the Western Ghats, it is just, the kind of unplanned tourism that has affected the Western Ghats area actually. So we now need to think about the ecotourism and things like that, okay? Provision of other information and then supporting services, okay? Indeed, there are enormous amount of ecosystem services coming from the natural environment, but they have not yet been recognized adequately. One of the reasons why they have not been recognized adequately is that they are highly valuable. They are being used in consumption and production functions of millions and millions of economic activities, no doubt about it. But only thing is, these ecosystem services, they are not being traded in the markets. They are non-market ecosystem services, and therefore their economic value is not at all recognized anywhere in the system. As a result, some of the ecological economists have estimated the economic values of these ecosystem services, the monetary values. For example, in 1996, some of the economists have used the economic values of various kinds of biomes, for example, marine ecosystem, coastal ecosystem, wetland ecosystem, freshwater ecosystem, forests, woodland, and then you see this agricultural ecosystem. Enormous benefits, non-market benefits, ecosystem benefits come from the agriculture ecosystem. Based on the available data, every hectare of the agricultural ecosystem, the agro-ecosystem, generates 3,839 US dollars worth of ecosystem values. In terms of Indian rupees, it is 2,76,429 rupees. 2,76,429 rupees worth of non-market ecosystem services are being generated by agro ecosystem. Of course, it includes food, fodder, all those kinds of things. But even if you net out this value, the quantum of the value of agro ecosystems is substantial, okay? For example, so as I said, these ecosystem services are highly valuable to the society, but they don't carry any market price because these services are not traded in the market. And also, agro ecosystem generate some disservices as well. It's not only ecosystem positive benefits, but also there are some negative services like global, the greenhouse gases, methane, yeah, pollution, air pollution, soil pollution and things like that, okay? So, if we make adjustments for the disservices, and then if we detect the value of the market ecosystems like food, afford, etc., what we end up is that every hectare of land generates 1,53,660 rupees worth of ecosystem services. This is how the farmer's income can be doubled. We also found that in certain cases it can be tripled. Okay, because some of the farmers are getting only 6,000 or 8,000 per year actually from their agricultural activities. So we have made adjustments for food, raw materials, recreation that are already marketed, and then for some kind of disservices coming from the farm activities. And after making adjustments, so the kind of value, economic value generated by the agriculture system is indeed substantial, with which one can compensate the farmers for taking up best agricultural practices actually, okay? So current system of intensive input based agriculture generates less of ecosystem services and more of disservices. And therefore, we have to move on to best agricultural practices like organic farming and things like that, which generate more of ecosystem services and less of disservices, okay? Current agricultural practices are harmful to ecosystem services, so there is a welfare loss which is equivalent to 6 to 8% of GDP. Indeed, this 6 to 8% of GDP is an enormous amount of damage, social cost actually, equivalent to 20 trillion. 1 trillion is equivalent to 1 lakh crore. Right now, the volume of GDP is equivalent to 250 trillion in India. So, around 20 trillion GDP comes from environmental destruction. Air pollution, water pollution, soil pollution.
Indian number? Or
yeah, Indian number. Indian number, yeah.
Can you expand a bit so we can understand?
Yeah. So basically, so look at the next bullet point. Around 18.5 lakh deaths per year are taking place due to air pollution. GHGs, air pollution from stubble burning, pesticide pollution, urban air pollution, so on and so forth. Plus, around 5 lakh deaths are being caused by water pollution, caused by industrial water pollution, pollution coming from the urban areas, pesticide pollution, pollution by fertilizer, and so on and so forth. Okay, so this 20 trillion is I mean worth of social cost includes the health cost, the reduction in agricultural production because of environmental pollution. For example, we have made estimation in Tirupur industrial pollution causes damage to agriculture. The entire agriculture sector in the Noyal River Basin has been devastated by the industrial pollution. So there is huge loss, but this is not identified anywhere in the system actually. You know, you keep on adding this industrial income as income in the GDP, but there is no room for deducting the destruction, social cost that had been imposed on the agriculture system actually. So this includes the entire damage cost imposed by various industrial, agricultural, and so on and so forth activities in the economy. There is a book by Muthukumar Mani, World Bank publication. So it's called Muthukumaran Mani. This book was published in the year 2013. Its title is called The Cost of Inaction. So he has used existing secondary data. Please remember, for most of the environmental destruction, there is no secondary data. I'll give you an example. Suppose you consume contaminated water, and because of that you develop some jaundice, okay? When you go to the doctor will not identify this jaundice caused by water pollution, contamination of water. He will simply administer some medicine, etc., and then your problem may be solved. But there is no documentation that most of the jaundice cases, hepatitis for example, are being caused by water pollution. So in India, there is no documentation about this attributability kind of this thing, okay? Many of the diseases are being caused by water-related problems, but there is no documentation, okay? There is no data. So based on the existing crude secondary data, Muthukumaran Mani made estimation that around 6 to 8% of the GDP comes from environmental destruction, which is added as income. Okay? So that's the issue. Did I answer your question? Yeah. Basically, there are a whole lot of kind of social cost coming from the environmental destruction, but this book identifies where the cost comes from, okay? Because of water pollution, because of air pollution, because of soil quality deterioration.
Put it simply, like for example, if more fertilizer used, there's a lot of nitrate which gets into the nitrate accumulation which is happening in the groundwater, and it has a health impact. But when we are looking at the rural health issues, we don't look at the nitrate pollution as an issue.
Yeah.
So only the benefit of using nitrogen fertilizer is...
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
We are not looking at...
Exactly. Because your agriculture, yes, your productivity, production, everything goes up, which shows up as increased income at the national level. But there is no room for reduced ground. Yes.
So if this is taken care, probably
yes.
That would not happen.
Exactly, exactly. Yes. So that is why we insist upon developing green GDP.
Yes, life cycle.
Yes. So in the case of green GDP, we try to deduct the social cost. So when the social cost goes up, the GDP comes down. Last week we had this meeting with the 15th Finance Commission. Many of the members in the 15th Finance Commission, they are interested in how to increase GDP growth. Can we increase GDP growth by 10%? I said that can be possible by destroying the environment. You exploit more groundwater, you pollute the environment in a rampant manner, your GDP will go up. Right now, the GDP increases because of increased destruction to the environment. That is what Muthukumaran Mani's study has demonstrated. And, okay. So, as I said, organic farming, best agricultural practices can generate more ecosystem services and less disservices, and GDP will grow maybe at a reasonably moderate rate, 6%, 7%, on a sustainable basis. Maybe for the next 10 years, 15 years, 25 years. Because right now, if you look at the GDP growth, there is huge oscillation. Last year it was 6%, and this year they say 8%, etc., etc. But we want a stable GDP growth over a period of time, which can be achieved only if we take into account the environment. Right now in Tamil Nadu, for example, there is a classic case. In 2011, All our bleaching and dyeing units in Tirupur have been closed because of environmental concerns actually. Court said you are not reducing water pollution and therefore you please close down. As a result, the entire industry, knitwear industry in Tirupur has been paralyzed. Now it is recovering. Your 25,000 crores worth of foreign exchange has been completely affected because of environmental problem. Okay, that's one classic case. The second thing is, very recently we closed sterilite factory in Tuticorin because of environmental problems. And this 8-lane road between Salem and Chennai has been now is in trouble because of environmental problem. Farmers are agitating now. Yadav, Yogendra Yadav, arrested, etc., because of environment. All our hydrocarbon projects in the Delta region, Kaveri Delta region, hampered because of environmental problems. So there are many such development and infrastructural projects which are being halted because of environmental problems. Genuine reasons. These are all genuine reasons. But now 15th Finance Commission is interested in increasing the growth rate of 8-10%. How will you do that? When all your development and infrastructural projects are in deep trouble because of environmental problems, how will you increase growth rate? Okay, it's a very, 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 important issue actually. So therefore, the economic value of net ecosystem benefit, the economic value of good ecosystem services minus the economic value of disservices will give you the net ecosystem benefits. Okay, from best practices such as organic farming is much higher than that of the current farm practices that are harmful to the environment, as demonstrated by some of the empirical studies by Muthukumar Mani and all those kinds of things. So now we have to develop scenarios based on the ecosystem services. Okay, so what are the scenarios? Some of the ecological economists who met at Chandigarh, where this Dr. Ram was also there, we developed these scenarios like this: increased carbon sequestration in soil because of organic farming, best agricultural practices, reduced water usage. Water is becoming a critical factor as far as India is concerned. Most of the farmers commit suicide because of water, right? One of the major reasons why farmers are committing suicide is because of water, especially groundwater. And then lower toxic residuals in soil because of increased use of fertilizer, all those kinds of things. You have increased toxins in the soil and therefore that need to be reduced. So there are three important scenarios: increased carbon sequestration, reduced water usage, lower level of toxic residuals. And that can be achieved by three different farm practices. Adaptation, where farmers undertake practices that result in all the three desirable outcomes, and a moderate level of adaptation, where ecologically sensitive practices like organic farming result in two of the desirable outcomes. It can be either increased carbon sequestration, reduced water usage, or reduced water usage or lower toxic level, or increased carbon sequestration, lower toxic level, whatever the kind of adaptation it may be, any two of them. And low level of adaptation, where ecologically sensitive practices result in only one out of these three things. Okay, it can be any one of these three things. Okay, so based on the extent of adaptation, the extent of PES payment must be determined. That means that if a farmer adopts all three different kinds of practices, then he should be compensated more than a farmer who adopts only low level of practices. Okay, so basically what you can do, you can look at the form practices right now. Okay, form practice A, form practice B, form practice C. It may be a current practice which is environmentally harmful, right? Practices. And you have, you know, X amount of net benefits generated, which is lower, and you have Y amount of net benefit, which is somewhat higher than the benefit generated by the X, and then you have Z amount of benefit, which is definitely higher than the two other practices. Actually, based on this, the compensation level may also vary. This person will be getting more compensation than this practice, and this person will be getting more compensation than these two practices. Okay, so that is how the payment for ecosystem services work actually. Okay, and then I don't know whether you are able to understand what I am trying to say here. Okay. Now the important question is, even though best practices like organic farming generate more ecosystem services benefiting not only the farmers, consumers, but also the entire society, because all your environmental damage cost will come down because of all these practices. The important question is how to change the behavior of most of the stakeholders, okay, the farmers especially, and the consumers, right?
In this one more category is the scientists.
Yes.
That's the major bottleneck which we yes. see, and the policy makers.
And the policy makers, yes.
So if you look at these four,
yes, yes.
Each needs a behavioral change.
Exactly. Exactly. But right now I am going to focus mainly on the consumers and the farmers themselves, because there are many problems with the farmers' behavior as such. I'm not blaming the farmers, but you know, from their own point of view, whatever they are doing is rational, right? So from our own point of view, it may not be rational, in the sense that if they change their behavior, they will benefit more. Right? So that is where the rationality comes in. So there is a problem between what we are prescribing to the farmers and what the farmers are actually doing. So how to overcome this problem? Behavioral issue, okay? Farmers take decisions depending on the past. What was the price of onion and tomato during last season? So based on that, I cultivate. Every farmer does this. So during the harvesting period, there is a price crash. Because if the tomato was selling at 100 rupees per kg, every farmer would be willing to cultivate tomato. And during harvesting period, the price crashes, and therefore they throw tomato on the roadside and things like that, because of various other problems, like there is no storage facility, there is no proper marketing, etc., etc. They throw. Onion, important crop, which is having this problem for centuries together, for decades together, okay? Milk is being poured on the roadside. Potato is being thrown on the roadside because of this problem. Why? This is because of the behavioral issue. Namely, farmers look at the price of the commodities that prevailed in the past, or there is a demonstration effect. Namely, whatever my neighbors do, I will also do. If every one of the farmers in this particular region cultivates tomato, I think that, look, tomato is going to be sold at the higher price, that is why all other farmers are doing, let me also do the same thing. Okay, as a result, the farmers are in distress. Okay, now farmers are influenced also by the status quo bias, which is a behavioral issue. That is, Even if more benefits come from organic farming, for some reasons they are not willing to go in for organic producers, but rather they try to stick to the current practices because of uncertainty, right? So on and so forth. Or my father was doing this particular kind of practice, let me also do it. Okay. Or I have been doing it for quite some time and let me continue with that because I am comfortable with this. Right? When Kaveri water was not available for the Delta farmers, government, Tamil Nadu government, Jayalalitha, told the farmers to change the cropping pattern. They said there are various other crops that can be cultivated with less amount of water. Why don't you go in for that? The farmer said, if you are not able to bring water from Karnataka, you rather accept your inability rather than suggesting. It's a very kind of strong belief among the farmers. They see water not coming in the Kaveri as a failure of the government rather than, you know, failure of their own kind of, you know, changing the behavior and things like that. Of course, exactly, mindset, yes. So these are all very informal kind of institutions embedded in the mindset of the people which cannot be easily changed, okay? Similarly, in the case of consumption of food, for example, okay? I have been consuming this food for quite some time, so let me not change my food consumption towards organic kind of food consumption. Okay, so these are all, as I said, from the people's point of view, these are all rational kind of behavior, but from our own point of view, this is not okay.